this year. There is some disturbing news today for vacationers planning to visit national parks in the eastern United States. Scientists say industrial pollution is making the air quality in some parks there worse than in Los Angeles. They blame sulfates from coal-burning power plants and other industries. In the West, meanwhile, strict emission regulations have actually improved conditions at several national parks there. In Washington, there is a move on to clean up America's waterways. Supporters say it will be good for America's coastline and bottom line. Deborah Potter with more.
Closed beaches keep the tourists away. Warnings not to eat the fish keep boats at the docks. Polluted water drains over $1 billion a year from the U.S. economy. With Congress debating expensive new requirements to clean up the water, administration officials are making the case that it makes economic sense, touring areas like Coney Island in New York, where business is driven by water.
Clean water is not only good for the health of the people of this country, for the health of our environment, but it's also good for the health of the economy.
But cleaning up the water won't be cheap. New sewage plants will cost more than $100 billion, and state and local governments say they'll be squeezed unless Washington puts up a bigger share of the money.
What happens at the local level? So then you don't have enough money for K-12 education. You start robbing your higher education. You get into other matters, or you raise taxes to the point local governments raise taxes through the roof.
Farmers worry, too, about the cost of controlling agricultural runoff, pesticides and fertilizers that foul the waterways. Some fear that tougher rules could put them out of business.
In some areas, they may have to take the dramatic steps, and in some areas, they may not. But for those in certain areas, very likely, they may choose to do something else.
The Clean Water Act was supposed to ensure that all U.S. waters would be fishable and swimmable by 1983. Now, more than 10 years later, the government says over a third of coastal waters, lakes, and rivers like the Anacostia are still too dirty. Officials say there's really no way to put a price tag on the value of clean water, but to counter complaints about the cost of cleaning up, a major factor in the congressional debate, the administration argues that the benefits add up to billions. Deborah Potter, CNN, Bladensburg, Maryland.
The fire's out now, but there's no explanation yet today for a deadly chemical plant fire in Ohio. An explosion yesterday morning rocked a plastics factory owned by the Shell Oil Company. At least one worker is confirmed dead. Two others are missing and presumed dead. The plant is located near Belpre, which is 70 miles north of Charleston, West Virginia. 1,700 people were evacuated for several hours from the area. Federal safety officials are now at the site. It was the beginning and end of life at a Miami hospital last night. Jorge Morales had just taken flowers to his wife, who had given birth 2 days ago. As he left the hospital, Morales and his five-year-old daughter got caught in a police crossfire. He was killed. His daughter was unharmed, though. Police, who called Morales an innocent victim, were trying to capture some armed robbers at the time. Two Milwaukee police officers are suspects today in a Chicago murder. They're also being questioned about the spraying of bullets into the home of Chicago Cardinal Joseph Bernardine. The head of the Chicago Catholic Archdiocese slept through the shooting yesterday, but later spotted bullets lodged inside of a door. Police believe the same gun was used in the murder of a nightclub bouncer. The officers have been suspended, but are not yet charged. Police in a small Pennsylvania town say they've cracked a 23-year-old murder mystery. They insist they could not have done it without a local man who claims his buried memory of the crime has now resurfaced. Brenda Waters reports that man's account has led to an arrest.
When you talk to people in downtown Katanning, Armstrong County, few people remember Franklin Crawford or the woman he is charged with killing back in October 1971.
Is this a big deal in this town that this man has been arrested after 23 years?
No, because everybody's asking everybody, you know, do you remember this? Or, you know, who is this man? Nope.
But the case is a big deal for the district attorney's office. It was a year ago that the big break came through. That's when John Reed, a man from Apollo, came forward to say he had witnessed the murder of 21-year-old Pearl May Altman.
He gave facts that were corroborated by other facts that would be known to the persons who were involved or who were present at the time of the offense.
Such as
the location of the body, where the parties were immediately before the body was found the next day, things that would be known primarily by those people who were there.
According to the assistant DA, Reed says he saw Crawford beat Pearl May and then throw her body in the Allegheny River. She was found in this area.
Reed, who could not be reached today, told police he now only remembers what allegedly happened because he had repressed the details, saying he had been threatened by Crawford. Reed was 16 years old at the time, but claims a year ago he saw a woman who looked like the victim and something clicked. Did you know Crawford? Did you associate with him at all?
I knew him, yes.
How was he?
He was a partier too. Drank and party. Carried on a lot. Done a lot of wild things.
Deb told me she used to party with Crawford and Altman at this place, now called the Pub. But in the 70s, it was known as the Hole.
She wasn't all mentally there. And a lot of people in town took advantage of her. I remember that. And I just tried to be her friend and party with her.
Was she fun going?
Yeah, carrying on all the time whenever she drank. Mm-hmm. And she trusted everybody.
Crawford, now 49 years old, is being housed at the Armstrong County Jail without bond. This is not his first time behind bars. Police say he served 8 years of a 14-year sentence for the murder of a 3-year-old child in 1973.
Congressman Dan Rostenkowski is denying reports he's turned down a plea bargain offer from the federal government. Chicago Sun-Times today is reporting, however, Rostenkowski will be charged Tuesday with multiple felony charges of corruption, barring any last-minute changes in that. Sun-Times says Rostenkowski will be indicted on charges he got cash illegally from the House Post Office, used government cars for personal use, employed as many as 18 ghost employees on his federal payroll, and that he illegally used taxpayer money to buy gifts. Rostenkowski has consistently denied any wrongdoing. Senior Clinton administration officials admit that two and not one presidential helicopters were used in a golf outing this week. They flew in tandem and took White House aide David Watkins and two senior officials to a Maryland golf course. Watkins resigned over the controversy this week. The cost of the trip, by the way, could top $10,000. White House officials are now pitching in to help Watkins pay for it. They say they're doing it as a gesture of friendship, but other sources indicate Watkins has refused to pay for it himself. President Clinton is hailing a military milestone in his weekly radio address today. He praised the Allied landing in Normandy 50 years ago next week. The D-Day offensive gave the Allies the upper hand in World War II.
It was the turning point of World War II, and in many respects, a turning point of the 20th century. It was the beginning of the end of Nazi tyranny and a down payment on all the years of freedom the rest of us have enjoyed ever since.
Wednesday, President Clinton flies to Italy, where he'll begin an 8-day European trip devoted to D-Day observances. North Korea's nuclear crisis is heating up again. UN inspectors warn Pyongyang is quickly removing fuel rods at its main nuclear reactor. If it continues, they say they'll lose the ability to detect any plutonium at the reactor within days. Inspectors won't confirm that no plutonium is being used to build nuclear weapons. Some members of the UN Security Council call that matter grave. They're meeting informally this weekend to consider what to do next. Business classes are rapidly replacing courses on Marxism at China's universities, but for citizens of the communist nation, not everything has changed. Patrick Brown reports students may still be penalized if they question government policies.
People's University was founded to turn out graduates who'd make China into a socialist paradise. Now it's trying to turn out graduates who'll make money. In the alma mater of generations of Marxist-Leninist bureaucrats, many of the library's 3 million books are now just so much waste paper. A third of the courses are being dropped. Planned economics, scientific socialism, and international communism are out. Business management, taxation, and marketing are in. Deputy Principal Li Wenhai is reluctant to concede that the university has spent 40 years teaching nonsense. You can't say those subjects were totally useless, he says. Historically, they had a great deal of influence. And indeed, Marxism isn't completely dead. A philosophy class still struggles with dialectical materialism. Philosophy is about human thought, world materialism, and ideology, he says. The class gets the attention it deserves. While just next door, Professor Lin Zhengjie is explaining what a real estate broker does. These middlemen make enormous commissions, he says. They make a fortune. The subjects taught in the university are changing, but one aspect of university life is not. Students are expected to take notes and not to ask too many questions. When People's University starts teaching capitalism, it's quite obvious to everyone that the emperor has no ideological clothes. But asking why a country which has abandoned communism still needs a communist party is a sure way to get a transfer out of the university and into the penal system. Patrick Brown, CBC News, Beijing.
The Environmental Protection Agency has given Utah State University $500,000 to study cow belches. Researchers will round up the cows, fit them with special masks, and measure the amount of methane the animals release when they burp. Methane is a known contributor to global warming. Some researchers estimate confined cattle produce 20% of global methane emissions. Six athletes at California's Stanford University have been charged with vandalizing a statue titled Gay Liberation. Two students face felony vandalism charges now, which carry possible prison time and fines of up to $10,000 each. Some students say there needs to be more awareness and understanding of gays and lesbians on campus.
The direct vandalism is a result of deeper things that are going on that could have been prevented if some of these guys had more exposure to these issues from the time that they entered this university.
You know, the gay and lesbian community has to be a little bit more tolerant of the fact that some people aren't very tolerant of them, and they have to communicate their lifestyle to them and make sure that you know, they aren't offended by it, and I think all of us will get along a lot better once that happens.
And university officials are estimating it'll cost about $8,000 to fix that statue. Next in Headline Consumer News, we'll review the week in business, and later, after 29 years of making left turns, Mario Andretti prepares to say goodbye to the old brickyard.
A stationary front will continue to bring showers and thunderstorms along the Gulf Coast. A cold front in the plains will bring rain. The east will stay dry and sunny.
This is Headline News, a CNN network.
Here's tomorrow's viewing schedule for AFN Television. What's on the schedule for tomorrow? AFN Television. We've got it all.
Kentucky Fried Chicken says it'll invest an additional $200 million in China over the next 4 years. The announcement coming at the opening of the company's latest Chinese outlet. The investment will boost the number of KFC stores in China to at least 200 in 45 cities. The expansion is also expected to create about 20,000 jobs. Kentucky Fried Chicken's announcement came a day after President Clinton's renewed China's most favored nation trading status, Jim Dexter has that and more in his look back at the week in business.
President Clinton renewed most favored nation trade status for China, but the future of trade with Japan was renewed most favored nation trade status for China, but the future of trade with Japan was still something of a mystery. Washington and Tokyo agreed to resume formal talks on opening up the Japanese market, but not everyone was impressed.
What this means is that 10 months after starting talks with Japan, we've agreed to start talks with Japan.
There were big bucks in the baby business. A Swiss conglomerate agreed to pay $3.7 billion to swallow Gerber baby food. Rupert Murdoch's plan for a fourth network was once considered a crazy idea, but some people now say crazy like a fox. Murdoch's Fox Television Network announced an investment deal that gives Fox some former CBS affiliates and gives CBS a black eye.
I think that CBS stock is probably going to be dead money for a while.
The tobacco industry started the week by launching an offensive against workplace smoking restrictions, but by the time the week ended, the industry had other problems. Florida and Mississippi took steps to sue cigarette makers to recover public money spent treating smoking-related illnesses. A tall order for Denny's. The restaurant chain agreed to pay $46 million to settle charges it discriminated against African-American customers.
These settlements are not an admission that Denny's has had a policy or practice of discrimination against African-Americans.
Walmart conceded that always the low price does not necessarily mean always the lowest price. The retailer agreed to change its longtime slogan to a less ambiguous claim, always low prices. How's this for a beer slogan? Tastes great, less filling, and reduces the national debt. The brewers of Billery Beer, named after President Bill Clinton and First Lady Hillary Rodham Clinton, said they'll help reduce the federal deficit with a 25-cent donation for each case of Billery Beer sold. Company officials say the national debt could be wiped out if they sell 200 trillion cases. That was the week in business. I'm Jim Dexter, CNN reporting.
Headline Sports is next.
This is Headline News, a CNN network.
This baby's a Grumman Hellcat, the toughest fighting bird in the Pacific, and that fact was proven again just last week. Seems the Japanese were getting concerned because we were steadily advancing up their coastline. So they met our fleet in the Philippine Sea, where 24 carriers and more than 1,000 planes went at it for 2 days. The first morning, they sent in almost 400 zeros and jibs, but we splashed 243 of them in just the first couple of hours. That was over half their total fighting force. It's no surprise, really. Our Hellcats have four wing guns to the Zeros, too, and we had over twice the engine power for better speed and maneuvering. They called it the Great Marianas Turkey Shoot, and most of the credit went to my baby. As long as our boys need Hellcats turned out, I'll be here to keep them flying.
The Battle of the Philippine Sea, an event that helped shape the outcome of World War II.
Hey, Sean, what you gonna do now?
I don't know. Maybe hang out for a while?
Hang out for a while? Hey, why not give one of the youth programs a try? Come on in here. Yeah, in here. I'll show you what it's all about.
Taking a nap in there or what?
Hey, why don't we head over to the youth center? I'll tell you guys all about it.
Looking for something to do? Check out the youth programs where you live.
I'm Jalon Jurenovich. Headline Sports. Stefan Matteau did it again as the Rangers advanced to the Stanley Cup Finals in a dramatic win over New Jersey. After the Devils forced the extra period on Valeri Zalepukin's goal with only 7 seconds remaining, Matteau scored the game winner in double overtime for the second time in the series. This one in Game 7, 2-1 the final.
On the hardwood, the Jazz picked up a must-win to cut the Rockets' lead to 2-1 in the NBA's Western Finals. Karl Malone scored 22, Jeff Hornacek 17 in the 95-86 final. Baseball, and it's good to see Steve Palermo back at the ballpark. He was telling the Scooter that Wade Boggs has a glove, too. The fine leatherwork helped the Yankees beat David Cone in KC 5-2. Unlike Cone's shutout streak that ended, Wilson Alvarez kept his winning ways intact. A White Sox record 15th straight decision in a 3-0 beating of Baltimore. Sandy Alomar and Jim Thome went deep for Cleveland, but it was Paul Sereno's blast in the bottom of the ninth that lifted the try by the A's 3-2, Mesa picking up the win. California topped Toronto, Big Frank with number 18 in the White Sox win. Jimmy Key the victory for New York. Milwaukee snapped his 14-game losing skid by beating Seattle. The Twins topped the Tigers, and the Rangers a winner over the Red Sox. The Dodgers blew a 4-run lead in the ninth, but rallied with two in the bottom of the tenth to beat the Pirates 6-5. Rookie pitcher Darren Dreyfuss the big hit in his first official big league at-bat. For a moment, the Mets reverted back to the team that lost 103 games last year. Not one, not two throwing errors, but three on the same play that allowed one run to score. Still even with the shenanigans at Shea, New York won easily, 10-2 over Cincinnati. Galarraga hit his 17th in a loss to Montreal. Mitch Williams back at the vet. He walked one, hit another. Houston still won. Greg Maddux won his 8th on the year for the Braves. Pete Smith, an 8-hitter for the Mets. The Dodgers in extras. The Padres beat Bob Tewksbury, and Patterson's grand slam led the Giants by the Marlins. At 9-under, Scott Simpson is the leader by two shots among golfers who have finished two rounds at the rain-plagued Southwestern Bell Colonial. Oscar De La Hoya survived a knockdown 9 seconds into the fight and retained his WBO junior lightweight title by stopping Giorgio Campanella in round three. While at the French, Arantxa Sanchez and Conchita Martinez moved on. American Lindsay Davenport did not. While on the men's side, Michael Chang bounced back in five. Jerome Jurenovich, Headline Sports.
This is Headline News, a CNN network.
Court convenes in a few minutes. I'm the trial counsel, same as a prosecutor in a civilian case. This is a general court-martial, which is for the most serious offenses, murder, treason, major crimes like that. There's already been a formal pretrial investigation. That's required for a general court-martial. Soon I'll be joined by the military judge, a panel of 5 service members, like a jury in a civilian case, the defense counsel, and a court reporter. The defense and I shall present the facts and the law and argue our cases. The judge decides questions of law. The panel decides innocence or guilt. It's similar to a civilian trial when you think about it. Judge, prosecutor, defense, jury. Innocent until proven guilty. A general court-martial has the same goal, to achieve justice.
All right.
Now you'll have to excuse me. The trial's about to start.
Have landed again in Irvine, California. The reunited rock band played their first public show in 14 years to a sold-out crowd. The group split up in 1980 after a 10-year career that included 4 Grammy Awards. The group will tour the United States and then much of the rest of the world throughout next year. In Garden Grove, California, some ducks have put residents there in a foul mood. A mother duck and her 6 ducklings have taken over a swimming pool at a local apartment complex. A Wildlife Protection Act, by the way, bars residents from bothering the ducks, though they could hire an authorized company to take them away. As one resident put it, they're sweet, but they're very messy. Ladies and gentlemen, start your engines. With that traditional call, officials will begin tomorrow's Indianapolis 500 for driver Mario Andretti. The call will signal the beginning of the end to 29 years of racing at the old brickyard. Nick Charles reports.
Mario Andretti's won everything worth winning in his 5 decades as a race driver. He's won in every kind of car on every kind of surface. But being at Indy Memorial Day weekend has been perhaps his most compelling fascination.
I've been dreaming about coming to this place since I was 13 years old, back in Italy. That's when I started racing. And, well, now I'm here, and it certainly is a realization of a dream.
That was 29 years ago, when Andretti's Indy Odyssey began with a bang. He finished third and was named Rookie of the Year. 4 years later, he won it all, in 1969. And who could have imagined that would be the last time Mario Andretti would roar into victory lane at the most famous racetrack on Earth? There were checkered flags by the dozens elsewhere, but only setbacks and disappointments at the old Brickyard.
When something good happens to you there, it's the biggest reward. When something doesn't happen, it's the biggest letdown. It's that simple. So because of that, you have all that roller coaster of emotions.
So while pieces of Mario Andretti's soul may be scattered around Indy's 2.5-mile oval, his talent, endurance, sheer will to win, and matchless style have been the cylinders that have fired his own personal engine, made him a hero, a millionaire, and won him the lasting admiration of those who have gone wheel to wheel against him, and those who have been thrilled by his persona.
I think Mario is bigger than life.
He's always been the Indy 500 to me.
They don't make heroes like they used to a long time ago. And like we see Mario, for example, as one of the last that really have a fabulous fan following and all just going away.
As for the legend himself, his final Indy brings regret, relief, and hope that those blurring 500 miles this time can be stretched out to last a lifetime.
In the sense, I feel sad, but in the sense, I feel thankful that I've been able to be in it for all these years. So this last time here, this last go-around, I want to try to really have some fun in the sense of try to enjoy it even more than before.
To the original Super Mario, the enjoyment has been ours every Memorial Day weekend for the last 29 years.
Nick Charles, CNN Sports.
Up in the next half hour of Headline News, a man claims he can make breasts bigger through hypnosis. Comfort at work can mean a more comfortable profit margin. And pleasingly plump figures are the art scene in Buenos Aires. I'm Charles Zewe, a whole day's news every half hour. This is Headline News.
This is Headline News, a CNN network.